In this example, I'd like to do a hypothesis test for population mean single sample for a right-tailed or upper-tailed test. And this is going to be the situation where sigma is known, so this will be a z-test. A light bulb manufacturer guarantees that the mean life of a certain type of bulb is more than 750 hours. A random sample of 25 bulbs has a mean life of 745 hours. Assume the population is normally distributed and the population standard deviation is 60 hours. At alpha equal 0.05, do you have enough evidence to support the manufacturer's claim? Now, I like to do this using the critical value method and the p-value method. The first step is to set up your null and your alternative, and to do that you need to identify the claim and rewrite it as a mathematical statement in terms of the parameter. Because this is a test about a mean, the parameter will be mu. So I have mu, and it says more than 750 hours. That does not include the case of equality. That's a strict inequality. This is the claim. And because it does not have the case of equality, this is the alternative. So the null in this situation is mu is equal to 750. Now, some textbooks that I use the complete mutually exclusive case. So in other words, if this is greater than, then some textbooks use less than or equal to in the null, still using the case of equality, however. This textbook, if you're taking my class currently, uses equals only in the null and has the sense of direction or inequality in the alternative. Ultimately, it doesn't matter what method, if we have less than or equal to up here. The confidence interval will give us more information about the nature of the parameter. So oftentimes that's a nice thing to include. Okay, so looking at this null and this alternative, I know that this is going to be an upper-tailed or right-tailed test. Because the population standard deviation is known, and because my sample size is less than 30, I need to be told that the population is normally distributed. So the conditions are met to use the Z distribution or use the normal distribution, the standard normal distribution, sorry. So the standardized test statistic formula is what we observed from the sample, which will be X bar, our point estimate, minus the claimed or the hypothesized value over sigma over the square root of n. So we want to determine if what we observe is statistically different enough to warrant rejection of the null from what is claimed. And we want to standardize by dividing by the standard error of the mean from the central limit theorem. So we're going to need these pieces. Reading the problem again, our sample size is 25. So n is 25. And from that sample, a mean life was found to be 745. So that's X bar. And we're assuming the population standard deviation, which is sigma, is 60, or 60 hours. All right, so plugging into this standardized test statistic formula, it's 745 minus 750, okay, that is the claimed value. In fact, the manufacturer is claiming it's more than 750. And even though these are different, this one is in fact lower. Is this difference enough to warrant rejection of the claim? Or sorry, rejection of the null? To do that, we need to standardize and compare it to a critical value. So I want to divide that by 60 over the square root of 25. Now I know this numerator is going to be negative 5. Negative over a positive, your denominator will always be positive, will yield a negative value. Because this observation is below the mean, I know I'm going to have a negative z-score. So if you wanted to put this into your calculator in one step, as you will, I suggest using parentheses around your numerator expression and your denominator expression. Now I know I can do that subtraction in my head, but I'm just showing you how you could input this into your calculator. Now I know the square root is 25. I'm sorry, the square root of 25 is 5, but I'm putting in the whole thing as is. So my standardized test statistic is negative 0.417, rounding to 3 decimal places. This is telling me that that sample mean X bar, what we observed, is 0.417 standard deviations below the mean. Okay, so that's definitely not an unusual value. Okay, to know for sure if we're going to fail to reject the null, we're going to need to compare it to the critical value. I have only one because this is a right-tailed test, and I need my level of significance to find that. This level of significance is an area or a probability. It's the probability of committing a type 1 error, but it's also the amount of area that we want in our rejection region. For a single tail test, we do not divide alpha in half. So I'm going to sketch the standard normal distribution. And shade my rejection region and indicate that I want 0.05 amount of area in it. There's a couple of ways to find this critical value. If you want to use your standard normal table, you need to remember the fact that it's going to read cumulatively from negative infinity up to the critical value. So you need to remember that there's 0.95 amount of area to the left of this critical value, and then you read outward to find that z-score. Or you could use your inverse normal function in the calculator. If you have an older TI-84, then you're going to have to put in the cumulative area, the amount of area to the left of that critical value. Whenever you're given an area first and working backward to find a z-score, you will be using the inverse normal function. So I can put in 0.95 here, leaving mu and sigma as is. And this left indicates that I'm inputting this area to the left of the critical value. And I expected my critical value to be positive because this is a right-tailed test. So this critical value is 1.645. Real quick, if you do have a newer TI-84, going back to that distribution menu, going back to inverse normal, I could put in an area of 0.05 and change that tail to right and see that I get the same critical value here. Okay, again, if you have an older TI-84, you could put in 0.05, but it's going to output a negative critical value, and clearly you're expecting a positive one, so just take the positive of it. So we want to compare our standardized test statistic to 1.645 along this horizontal axis. If it's greater than 1.645, we will be rejecting the null. If it's less than 1.645, we will be failing to reject the null. Now, I hope it's obvious that negative 0.417 is safely in the fail to reject region. And I will not be rejecting the null. In fact, I am nowhere near the rejection region, and I'm going to be failing to reject the null. Okay, so my null hypothesis is the quote-unquote winner in this situation. The claim is not circled because I am not rejecting the null. And to answer the question, do you have enough evidence to support the manufacturer's claim? To correctly answer that, you need to say that there is not enough evidence, or there is insufficient evidence to support the manufacturer's claim. Now, we can reach the same decision by using the p-value method. Because this is a right-tailed test, in terms of an extremity, the p-value is going to be the area from our standardized test statistic to positive infinity. The definition of the p-value is the p-value is the probability of getting a test statistic at least as extreme as the one obtained by the sample. So the p-value is a probability. Using the p-value method, you are comparing areas. You're comparing the p-value to alpha. And if the p-value is greater than or equal to your level of significance, you're going to fail to reject the null. Clearly, this area is going to be greater than 0.05. And also, because I'm below the mean, I expect my area or p-value to be greater than 0.5. So let's go ahead and find the p-value. When you're given a z-score first and looking for an area or a probability, using your calculator, you want to use the normal CDF function under the distribution menu. So selecting normal CDF, my lower bound in this case is negative 0.417. My upper bound theoretically is positive infinity, but I'm just going to put in a large number. Working with standard normal, so this area is 0.662, this larger area. What was that? 0.662. And I don't have to double this because I did not break alpha in half. So for a single-tailed test, you do not need to double the p-value if you're not going to use technology to find that p-value. So my p-value of 0.662, comparing it to alpha, is 0.05. I'm hoping that it is obvious that this is greater than or equal to 0.05. I know my decision is to fail to reject the null, which is the same decision I got when I used the critical value method. Now again, some textbooks put this case of equality with a less than or equal to for rejection, and some websites also do that. The case of equality is somewhat arbitrary, but I am doing it this way to be consistent with the current text.